Right, so this is the semi-free, I'm talking about the semi-free monad, and at the core of this talk should be a paper that I wrote with my ex-master student Ralph Sarkis, who's now a PhD student at ENS Lyon. But I realized that in order to introduce a lot of motivation and context, there is also a lot of work based on Alexandre Goy's PhD thesis, my former PhD student, who is now also a postdoc at Lyon. It's fair to say that this is work with both of them. And secondly, I'd like to apologize for not being there in person in Tbilisi. I've been to Tbilisi twice, which is like a lifetime ago. And it was really, I have some wonderful memories. So, but now due to family constraints and to teaching constraints, it was been impossible for me to travel at this time of the year. Let's get started with an overview of the talk. I will speak first about the motivation and context, and tell you why are we interested in the first place in semi-free algebras for a monad and in this semi-free monad construction. And the motivation comes from a concept of weak distributive laws, which was recently introduced by Garner in order to understand how the Vietoris monad on compact Hausdorff spaces can be seen as a lifting of the powerset monad. And together with my student Alexandre Goy, we found also lots of applications of, the, of this concept of weak distributive laws in semantics in trying to explain how we can combine systematically effects such as probabilistic choice and non-determinism. I will speak a bit also about extensions of our work to a continuous setting. And then to come to the core of the talk, I will introduce the semi-free monad and some examples of concrete presentations for semi-algebras. And finally, the slogan would be that weak distributive laws in some sense are strong distributive laws if we tweak a bit the monads. And I will end with some future work. So about the motivation and context, what is a computational effect? We have an interaction between a program and its environment, and there are many examples such as error raising, input and output, global and local state, continuations, and finally non-determinism and probabilistic choice. This would be the two examples which will be crucial into our work. The question that comes often in semantics is how can we compose systematically such computational effects? How do they interact with each other? And this has been a problem that was challenging for quite some years now. And we will see later on a few references about how this problem could be tackled. And the approach that I am taking in this talk would be to model computational effects using the concept of monads, so following the seminal work by Eugenio Moggi, and to consider an adapted category theoretic tool for composing monads. So this will be the weak distributive laws that I've mentioned on the previous slide. So first of all, what are semantic models for non-determinism and probabilistic choice? If we think a bit about it algebraically, not in terms of monads, non-deterministic choice should be modeled by some operation that should be commutative. If I have a choice between P or Q, it's the same thing as choosing between Q and P. It should be idempotent, because if I can choose between P and P, it's just taking P. And finally, it should be associative. Probabilistic choice, on the other hand, could be modeled by a family of operations. These are this plus R that I am writing here. And the semantic of P plus RQ would be that process P happens with probability R, while process Q happens with probability 1 minus R. And this should satisfy the axioms of a barycentric algebra, So for example, we have a skew form of commutativity. P plus R Q should be equal to Q plus 1 minus R T. So, and this matches the intuition that P happens with probability R and Q happens with probability 1 minus R. And there are a few more other axioms that are natural, and these are the axioms of barycentric algebras, sometimes called convex algebras. And we will see later that these are the algebras for some for the monad finite distributions. So the question is, how do we combine such the two operations? And it would be normal to have some form of distributivity between these families of operations. And this has a long history in the area of semantics, and especially in domain theory. So there is the thesis of Jones and her papers with Plotkin about probabilistic power domain of evaluations. The definition of the probabilistic power domain on a suitable category of domains has triggered a lot of papers, and there were also a lot of mistakes in the literature at some point. So there is a nice paper of Jung and Tix about a troublesome probabilistic power domain. More recently, there was work of Mislov and also of Tix, Kaimel, and Plotkin about how to combine the theory of probability and non-determinism. And one important paper is this LMCS 2017 paper of Kaimel and Plotkin about mixed power domains for probability and non-determinism. And there are also other approaches, in particular of Jean-Goubeau Larec. So there is recent work about this, even in Leaks 2019, about probabilistic and non-deterministic call by push value languages. So there are various approaches of how to combine the non-determinism and probabilistic choice using power cone models, using provision models or index valuations, coproduct of monads. And we will add up another way of doing this using weak distributive laws. More recently, there was a lot of work in the algebraic community. Because people there were usually exploiting distributive laws in the standard sense for combining monads and for giving semantics for coalgebras, in terms of coalgebras for composed functors. And in particular, there will be two papers to which I will come back a bit later. The power of convex algebras in Concours 2017 of Bonke, Silva, and Sokolova, and the theory of traces for systems with non-determinism and probability, again by Bonke, Sokolova, with Vinidelli this time, where ways of combining non-determinism and probability were studied from a coalgebraic point of view. And yet, in all these papers, there is a missing category theoretic perspective that will be filled by the notion of weak distributive laws. So what are monads? Because this is the perspective that I am taking in this talk, they are a category theoretic notion generalizing the standard universal algebra notion of algebraic theory, where you have algebras which are presented by some operations, some signature, and also quotiented by various equations. And concretely, a monad consists of, say, the triple sometimes called, because it consists of three pieces of data. So there is the functor S, there is a natural transformation eta S from the identity on C to S, and there is the multiplication of the monad, which goes from S composed with S to S. And all this should be subject to some coherence axioms. And the intuition in set, what is this? If I give you some algebraic theory in universal algebra given by operations and equations, well, S of X will be all the terms that you can build up using your operations and where you pick the variables from your set X. And then the multiplication of S, it's like a flattening of terms or a substitution. So you are basically looking at a term of terms and you are seeing it as a big term. Whereas the unit is simply taking a variable, and you see it as a very simple term that consists only of that variable. So there is this standard, very well-known correspondence between finitary monads on set and finitary algebraic theories in the universal algebraic sense. So to model non-deterministic choice from a monadic perspective, we can use the powerset monad, and this corresponds to a complete sup semilattices. So the Eilenberg-Moore algebras for the powerset monad are just the complete sup semilattices. So now you can take the join of arbitrarily many elements in some set X. So concretely, this monad is given by the following data. So you have the power set functor on set, so the covariant power set functor, which on a function f is defined using direct image. The unit is mapping an element in X to the singleton, and the multiplication is given by flattening. So you are taking the union of a family of sets. And all this should satisfy usual axioms. So this would be the monad that we will consider in this talk for non-determinism. Finally, we have the second example that I want to emphasize in this first part of the talk is the one for the monad for probabilistic choice. And here we use the finite distribution monads. So to a set of X, you consider all the probability distributions that have a finite support. And you will see that this monad corresponds to the algebraic theory of barycentric algebras. So the functor, it goes from set to set. So to a set X, as I said, you take all the distribution on X with the support finite. And for a function f, so d of f is defined by taking a forward image. The unit of this monad takes a singleton X to the Dirac distribution, so all the everything is concentrated in X, and the multiplication is again a form of flattening. So you are taking a probability distribution on distributions on X, and then you obtain a distribution on X by multiplying each X. So you're taking here a sum phi on the distributions on X, and you're taking phi of phi multiplied with phi of X. And again, one can check that all this data satisfies the usual axioms of a monad. And now the question is, how do you combine in general two monads? So if you have a monad T and the monad S, how can you obtain a monad structure on the composite functor ST? Well, there are some, you can see that it's very rather easy to define the unit of the monad, but how do we define the multiplication ST, ST? So this should have type ST, ST going to ST. And if I depict the terms in S by blue and the terms in T by red, I should have, so ST are term, blue terms of red terms, and I have two layers of this, and I should obtain a blue term of red terms. So how can I do this flattening using the fact I can use the fact that S and T are themselves two monads. So I have a multiplication for S and a multiplication for T. Well, it would be nice if I could just swap these two rows of terms. And then if I could pull up the blue terms, then I could use the multiplication of S, and then on the bottom, I could use the multiplication of T. So what is really needed, works very well, is a way of swapping S and T using a natural transformation from TS to ST. But in order to make everything work nice, it can't be any natural transformation. So there should be some compatibility with this, with the units and multiplication of the two monads. So this leads to the notion of distributive law. And the distributive law of the monad S over the monad T. So you have a natural transformation from TS to ST. which behaves well with respect to the unit and the multiplications of the two monads. So if you look at the diagram that I have here on the left, in the upper corner, I have TTS. I can flatten this to T with the multiplication of T to go to TS, and then I can do the swapping gamma. Or another way is to apply T to gamma. So I swap this T and this S. Then I do swap this T and this S with gamma T. And then finally, I can flatten the two T's into a T using the multiplication. So this is the compatibility of gamma with the multiplication of T. And similar one for multiplication of S. And finally, you have, for example, this compatibility with the unit of T. So from S, I can go to TS by using the unit of T followed by S. And on the other hand, I can use the S applied to the unit of T. And then this should commute with my swapping gamma. And a similar one for eta S. So you have these natural, rather natural coherence conditions for a distributive law. And this is a very well-known concept since the 70s, since the work of Beck. And you have a very rich rich theory. So that everything, almost everything is contained in the original paper by Beck, perhaps not as much the correspondence with the Kleisler category of a monad that I will describe right now. But it's a very standard standard theory. So we have the following correspondences. So on one hand, given two monads, S and T, you have these distributive laws from TS to ST, and you can show that these are in one-to-one correspondence with extensions T hat of T to the category Kleisli of S. So what is Kleisli of S? These are just the free algebras for the monad S. And here I say extension because the monad, so the lifting T hat, this is the, so the, sorry, the extension T hat. So this should be a monad on the category of free algebras for S. And it should commute, so this square should commute, but notice that here I am using the free functor from C to Kleisli of S. So if I apply T hat to some free algebra over some objects in C, it's the same thing as obtaining the free algebra over T applied to that object. And T hat should have also the structure of a monad on this category of algebras. So this is one correspondence between extensions to Kleisli and distributive laws to Kleisli of S. And on the other hand, you can consider liftings of the other monad, of the monad S, so a lifting S hat, but this time to the category of Eilenberg-Moore algebras for T. So here you look at all the algebras for the other monad, for the monad T, and here it's called a lifting, not an extension, because the square which commutes, in this square, I am not considering the free functor. So there is also a free functor going from C to Eilenberg-Moore. But here in this square, I am rather considering the forgetful functor from the category of T algebras to C. So this means that if I start with some algebra for the monad T, I forget about its structure and then I apply the functor S. This is the same thing as applying the functor S hat and then forgetting about the algebraic structure. And again, S hat has also to, is also equipped with some monad structure. So, and this is, all these three concepts, lifting, extensions, and distributive laws, they are in one-to-one correspondences. And if you have one of these ingredients, then you can produce a monad structure on the composite ST, which satisfy the following properties. The Eilenberg-Moore algebras for this monad ST are precisely the Eilenberg-Moore algebras for the monad S hat. So S hat is in itself a monad on algebras for T, and you can consider its algebras. And these are the same as the algebras for the composite monad ST. So this is a monad on the category C. And furthermore, this can be described in terms of algebras for this distributive laws in the following sense. So what is a gamma algebra? It is an object of the underlying category X, which is equipped with an Eilenberg-Moore T algebra structure A. So this is A going from Tx to X. You also have an S Eilenberg-Moore algebra structure. This is this arrow B from Sx to X. And moreover, the two algebraic structure need to be compatible using the distributive law gamma. So this means that the pentagon obtained here, so if you start with Tsx, you apply T to B to this arrow B, so you go to Tx and then you do an A. This is the same as swapping T and S, going to Sdx, taking S to the algebra, the T algebra structure A, and then composing with the B with the S algebraic structure, which is called B. So the standard example, which is in Beck's paper, is how you can obtain rings by combining commutative abelian groups and monoids, and how the standard distributivity that you have between multiplication and addition can be seen as an instance of such a distributive law between the corresponding monads. So distributive laws are, in some sense, a way of translating to a category theoretic setting the distributivity between the algebraic presentations from standard universal algebra. And this is a very well-known standard theory of distributive laws, but the problem is that there are several instances and where you have nice, decent-looking monads, and nevertheless, you don't have a distributive law. And the two monads that I have just described before, the power set and the finite distribution monad, is such a situation. So you have already in Daniele Baracca's PhD thesis a proof of the fact that there is no distributive law of the power set monad over the finite distribution monad. So this is credited to Plotkin. And if you go through the proof of this fact, you see that they start with the assumption that there is such a distributive law, and then there is a very smart use of naturality and of the unit of the two of the monad D of the monad of distributions. So we will come back to this example, but just to say that even if this distributive law theory is extremely rich, there are situations when it fails to work. And if you look at all the papers that I've mentioned from domain theory, from but also from the algebraic community about probabilities and about how to combine non-determinism and probabilistic choice, you always find a lot of complaints about this, the lack of such distributive law between the monads which are involved. And this means that many a times the theory has to be recreated by hand. The highlighted papers here is again the problem with the lack of a distributive law and the fact that you don't have a lifting, and somehow this has to be constructed, such a lifting has to be constructed in an ad hoc manner, and you don't know in what way it is canonical. Again, so next I show handmade presentation for this monad. So many of the results that should automatically come from almost for free from category theoretic results now are have to be recreated. And there are more negative results. For example, Klein and Salamanca show that there is no distributive law of the power set monad over itself. Furthermore, and it's a stronger result, that there is no monad structure on the power set functor composed with itself. So here we have, we are speaking about the covariant power set, of course. And they also gave more general conditions under which you don't have a distributive law of the form TP to PT, where T satisfies some further conditions. Furthermore, Svart and Marsden in a Leaks 2019 paper generalized Plotkin theory, again from mostly from an universal algebraic perspective, and again they gave a very large array of non-existence results for distributive, for strong distributive laws. So how can we work around this problem? Well, how can we combine, for example, some computational effects in the absence of a distributive law? One way of doing it is to change a bit the monad involved. So this was the solution proposed in Daniele Varapa's thesis, where instead of the monad of finite distributions, he used the monad of index valuations. Other solutions proposed were to define by hand a monad of, this is called a convex power set on the category of barycentric algebras. And this is something that goes back to papers by Tix et al. And more recently was for set monads was done in the paper, The Power of Convex Algebras by Bonke, Silva and Sokolova. The question that is still was still mysterious is, all these constructions are very nice, but how can we explain them using only category theoretic tools, and whether they are canonical in some sense? So the question that we can ask ourselves, and that I will describe in the next part of the talk, is how far away are we from a distributive law? So for example, do we have at least some natural transformation between the distribution functor, the finite distribution functor, and the power set functor? And if yes, of course, it cannot satisfy all the four axioms which appear in the definition of a distributive law, but maybe some of them are still satisfied. And we will see that three of them actually work fine for one canonical natural transformation that we can find. And we recover the concept of weak distributive laws, which was recently introduced in this exact shape by Garner in 2019. And the example that he had in mind was involving the distributive law between a weak distributive law between the power set monad and the ultrafilter monad. And using this, he showed how the Vietoris monad on compact Hausdorff spaces, and so these are the algebras for the ultrafilter monad. So the Vietoris monad can be seen as a weak form of lifting for the power set functor. So this is what I will speak about next. So in order to find the natural transformation from DP to PD, we use the fact that such transformations should, if I'm only looking at the functor part of D, but I still recall the fact that the power set is a monad, then natural transformation between the functor D and the power set monad P should correspond to extensions of T to the category of, to the Kleist-Lie category of the power set. So the Kleist-Lie category of the power set consists of, can be equivalently described as the category of relations, so where objects are sets, and the morphisms between them are relations. And there is a well-known result due to Barr that says that if I have a functor T which preserves weak pullbacks, then it can be extended to a locally monotone, a two-functor, from rel to rel. And we know that this locally monotone functor in turn should lead to a natural transformation. And then there are two independent, so the fact that the functor D preserves weak pullbacks, it was something proved independently in papers by De Ving and Rutten, respectively in Moss in the same year. So we can apply Barr's result. So we have a weak extension, a locally monotone extension of the functor D to the category of relations, and we obtain a canonical distributive law between D and P, which is obtained in the following way. So this is the standard construction going back to bar. We can consider the relation between Px and x, where we say that a set A is in relation with x if x is an element of A. Okay, so this is a relation between Px and x. And now if we apply, what we will do, we'll apply the lifting D to this relation, and we obtain the following distributive law, between the functor and the monad. So starting with a distribution phi on Px, gamma will transform phi, we obtain the set of distributions on X, such that there is some distribution on this set belongs to, with the projection, such that the first project, applying the first projection to Psi, we obtain our phi. And if we apply the second projection, we obtain the little phi. So what does this mean concretely? If we spell out the definition, if phi is the distribution PIAI, so the AI are sets, subsets of X, and PI are real numbers such that the sum of the PIs is one. So this is a distribution on PX, on the power set of X, then gamma of phi will be of the following form. So we are obtaining distribution on DX by taking some distributions phi I on dx such that the support of each phi I is included in the set AI, and then we take the sum of PI phi I. So we are taking a convex combination of distributions. Each distribution has to be supported by AI, and here we are using the same coefficients as in the distribution phi. So this gives a canonical distributive law of the functor D over the monad P. And it turns out that this natural transformation automatically will behave well with respect to the unit of the monad P, and also of the multiplication of the power set monad. And why is that? Because it was obtained via an extension of D to the Priestley category of the power set monad. So two of the four axioms of a distributive law were settled for. And now what we see next is that between the remaining two, so we have the axiom for the unit of the distribution monad and the axiom for the multiplication of the distribution monad. And we will see that the one for the unit will fail, whereas the one for the multiplication works just fine. In order to show this, we rely on another generic result, which also goes back to the papers of Barr, namely assuming that we have two weakly preserving functors, T and T prime, with their respective extensions, T bar and T prime bar, to the category of relations. Then if we have a natural transformation between the two functors, this extends automatically to a natural transformation between their relational extensions, if and only if the natural transformation alpha has the property of being weakly Cartesians. This means that each naturality square of alpha is a weak pullback. And using this result, we can show that the unit of the distribution monad is not weakly Cartesian. So for example, if you take the unique map from a two-element, from the two-element set 0, 1 to 0, then the naturality square of this, for this map, is not a weak pullback. Why is that? I mean, if you go from 0, 1 to 0 and then you apply the unit, here you get the Dirac distribution on zero. Okay, whereas here, if you consider the distribution that on the set 0, 1, so you have 0 with probability 1 over 2 and 1 with probability 1 over 2, so this is just fine, a distribution in here. This is also mapped by the map D bank to the Dirac distribution on zero, because both zero and one, they are mapped to zero. So you have that zero and this little phi here are mapped to the same thing, namely to the Dirac distribution on zero. But there is no way of obtaining phi in the image of this eta, because in the image of eta, you only have Dirac distributions, and this is not obviously a Dirac distribution. So this square here is obviously not a weak pullback. The natural transformation eta is not weakly Cartesian, so it cannot be lifted to a natural transformation between the relational extensions. On the other hand, we can show that the multiplication is weakly Cartesian. So this is what I've done with my PhD student, Alexandra. The proof that we had in our Leeds paper in 2020 was something a bit tricky. We were relying also on a result on Farkas lemma, the existence and the non-existence of a solution for some linear equation system. In the end, there was a slightly nicer proof independently found by Fritz and Perone in MFPS the same year, slightly later. It was published a bit later and with completely different purposes. But the point is that this multiplication is weakly Cartesian, and using this fact, we can show that we obtain the third axiom from a distributive law involving the multiplication of D that actually works in this particular case. We observe now that we are in the same situation as in the recent paper of Richard Garner, which is called the Vietoris monads and weak distributive laws. So the statement from his paper is the following. You have some monad T on set, and you have that if T, eta, and mu are all weakly Cartesian, then you have this canonical extension of T to the category of relations. So you have equivalently a canonical lifting of P to the algebras, and equivalent is not written here, but it's obviously true, a distributive law from TP to PT. On the other hand, and this is the point which is of interest to us, if only T and mu are weakly Cartesian, so this is also the case for the distribution monad, then there is still a canonical weak extension of T to rel, and so a canonical weak lifting of power set to T algebras. And also, what we will see, a canonical weak distributive law of the form TP to PT. So he applied this to see the Vietoris monad as a weak lifting of the power set monad. So in the application that he has, when T here is the ultrafilter monad, so the T algebras will be compact Hausdorff spaces, and the weak lifting of the power set to T algebras is this Vietoris monad. And we do the same thing, but we apply it not to the monad beta, the ultrafilter monad, but rather to the monad D of finite distributions. And this is the notion of weak distributive laws that I was mentioning, where, it's copy-pasted from the slide of distribution of distributive law, except that I omit the fourth axiom involving the unit of the monad T. So I only keep three of the four axioms. And again, the theory of weak distributive laws was again developed in this paper of Garner. I mean, one can adapt Barr's results in this setting. So to weak distributive laws of the shape from TS to ST, now we have a notion of weak extension of T to the Kleisli category of S. So what is this? I mean, you still have a functor T hat on Kleisli of S, only that now T hat, it is a weak extension. What does weak mean? It is not a monad anymore. it only has a multiplication satisfying the associativity of the multiplication, but t hat is not equipped with a unit. So it's something like we call it a semi-monad. And, but again, the functor should satisfy this commutative square, where again I use the free functor from C to Kleisli of S. So this is one correspondence that works out very well. Another correspondence, which is here, and the little star is to remind me that there is a one condition which is made, that the underlying category has to have split idempotents. So under this mild assumption, you have a notion of weak lifting of S hat to S, a weak lifting S hat of S to the category of algebras 14. So this time S hat is a monad. So you have the multiplication, you have the unit subject to the usual axioms. But now the square involved here is no longer commutative. Okay, so here you have again the forgetful functor from the algebras to C, but instead of having a commutative square, you do have two cells, so an inclusion and a sort of a closure operator. So the example that one can have in mind here is when C is a set, T is the monad of the ultrafilter monad beta. So here one has compact Hausdorff spaces. So the forgetful functor is simply forgetting about the topology. S is power set, and S hat will be Vietoris. And we know that the Vietoris, when we apply it to a compact Hausdorff space, we only take the closed sets, not all sets. So the square can't be commutative, because here you obtain, if you go first down, forget the topology and take the power set, here you obtain all the subsets of your topological space. Whereas if you do first go right here, you take the closed subsets and then you forget about the topology. So on one side, you obtain all the subsets. On the other side, you obtain only the closed subsets. It's not the same thing, but you have an inclusion. You have that the closed subsets are in particular subsets. And conversely, the pi here is the closure operator. You take a subset and you can take its closure. And these two notions, in fact, I mean, the two cells I and pi are the general way of understanding these operations. So the notion of weak lifting of S hat is not as easy to, I mean, I don't put the constraints, I mean, all the axioms that I and pi, these two cells have to satisfy. So they are in Garner's paper, but they are there. And if you have this this weak lifting, then you are able also to obtain a monad structure on a functor, which is very close to ST. So this is not the composite ST, it's close to it. It can be obtained using a splitting of some idempotent, and in such a way that the algebras for this lifted monad S hat are the same as the algebras for this weak composition, with form of composition ST hat. And again, these algebras for the weak lifting can also be described as gamma algebras, and here the definition is precisely the same as in the situation of strong distributive Lors. So again, you have an object X equipped with a T algebra structure, an S algebra structure subject to this commutative pentagon, which means that the two algebraic structure behave well with respect to the weak distributive Lore. So what we did in our paper was to show that we have a weak distributive law of the power set monad over the finite distribution monad, and that the corresponding weak lifting of the power set monad to the category of algebras for the distribution monad, so these are the convex algebras, is nothing but the well-studied monad, convex power set monad. So in this way, we obtain this this convex power set monad that takes a barycentric algebra or a convex algebra and maps it only to the subsets of its convex algebras, which again can be equipped with a convex algebra structure, we can obtain this convex power set monad in a canonical way, as exhibiting it as a canonical weak lifting of the power set. And the proof of this result was summarized below. So we rely on these results of bar for relational extension. We use the fact that we have the power set monad involved in this distributive law, and the Kleist category for it is rel. We use the fact that the functor D preserves weak pullback, and also that its multiplication as a monad is weakly Cartesian. So this was the main result that starting at least my personal interest in weak distributive laws. And we can see that this has application to semantics, for example, for determinization of probabilistic automata. If you have some probabilistic automata here, so here you have from a state x0, you have some non-determinism. You can go either to this state or to this state. And from each of these states, you have you can choose. So you have a probabilistic choice. For example, from here, you go with probability 1/2 to x1 and with probability 1/2 to x2. Or here, you can go with probability 2/3 to x2, and 1/3 you can go back to x0. So this is an example of a system that involves both non-deterministic choice and the probabilistic choice. And you can transform this into a system where the states are now probability distributions and where you only have non-determinism going on. So somehow you got rid of the probabilistic choice by incorporating them into your states. So it's a much bigger system. So here from x0, you can go, for example, to the distribution 1/2 x1 plus 1/2 x2, which you obtain here, or you can go to the distribution 1/3 x0 plus 2/3 x2 with an a, or you can go with an a to every convex combination of these two distributions. So these are called belief state transformers, and they have been and the way of understanding this, the process of transforming such a probabilistic automaton into a belief state transformer bears similarities to the way of determinizing a non-deterministic finite state automaton, obtaining a deterministic one. I mean, there this perspective is very clear if you think about these systems from a algebraic perspective, because here, such a system, you can see it as a map from X to a way of combining distributions and power set. So you have power set of distributions on X. Whereas here, you would have a system that goes from distribution on X to power set of distributions of X. So all this transformations can be seen, can be explained nicely if we use distributive laws. So especially the determinization of NFAs, this is something that was done in the work of Alexandra Silva and Jan Rutten and Marcello Bonsange. They had this generalized determinization where they explained this this way of obtaining the determinization of an NFA using a distributive law. So the question that was approached also in the algebraic community is whether from the probabilistic automata one can obtain belief state transformers in the same way. So this was what happened in the paper of Filippo Bonchi, Alexandra Silva, and Anna Sokolova. And they've done this a bit, they use the power set, the convex power set monad, but they had to recreate, because of this lack of a distributive law, they had to recreate a lot of the theory by hand. And what we show that things become much nicer to explain in the presence of a weak distributive law. So this is what we have here. And we have this generalized, sorry? Is there a question or a... Okay, I heard some noise. Consider, so we have a weak distributive law from TS to SD, and we have the weak lifting of S to the category of T algebras, which is denoted by S hat. And then we have the following way of transforming ST coalgebras into S hat coalgebra. So from C to the category of T algebras, one has a free functor. Okay, so to some object in C, I can construct the free T algebra. And now this functor can be lifted to a functor between the category of coalgebras for ST going to the coalgebras for this S hat. So a coalgebra for S hat is a map that starts with, so it's a map from an algebra, from a T algebra to S hat applied to that algebra. So the carrier of such a coalgebra is an Eilenberg-Moore algebra of T. So here I have the vertical arrows here are simply the forgetful functors that forget this, give me the carrier of my my coalgebra. And on the other hand, one also has this, the other way of lifting also the forgetful functor from T algebras to C. This also lifts to a functor from coalgebras of S hat to coalgebras over S. So now the example, the instance that we have here when T is the distribution monad and S is the power set monad. So on, in this corner, we will have coalgebras for power set composed with D. So this will be the probabilistic automata that I mentioned before. Here we have coalgebras for the convex power set monad. And these coalgebras will have carriers, convex algebras, that is algebras for the distribution monad. And the procedure of moving from coalgebras for PD to coalgebras of convex power set is precisely given by this free construction. So this, I was just saying this, sorry, that this is an instantiation of transforming a PD coalgebra into a PC coalgebra. So you take a probabilistic automata and you transform it into a Belief straight transformer. And this explains what happened in the paper, the power of convex algebras in a very systematic way. And similarly, in another paper of Bonke, Sokolova and Vignedelli, they considered, I mean, motivated by semantics and trace semantics of system involving both non-determinism and probability, they had to consider a concrete presentation for the algebras for a convex power set composed with, so for this monad, so the algebras for the convex power set monad are the same thing as, I mean, algebras for convex power set of distributions. And these are the so-called convex semilattices, defined concretely as follows. So you have some set X equipped with a subsemilattice, complete subsemilattice structure, also equipped with a barycentric algebra or a convex algebra structure. So you have all this operation plus R, where R is some number in 0, 1. And furthermore, so on one hand, you should have the complete subsemilattice structure. On the other hand, you should have the convex algebra structure, and between them, this distributivity axiom that the plus R, so the probabilistic choice operator, should distribute over the sup. Okay, so the join of xi plus ry should be the join of xi plus ry. And it turns out that these things are exactly algebras for the weak distributive law that we were considering. So you can obtain this algebraic presentation, modulo some stuff that has to be, I mean, in their Lix paper, they considered only finitely generated ones. So if you have to restrict also to finitely generated ones. So there is a little asterisk reading a little thing that has to be taken care separately about finite generatedness. But other than that, this convex semilattices could be described in terms of this algebras for gamma for the weak distributive laws. So again, this explains how a concrete distributivity axiom at the level of universal algebra stems from this notion of distributive laws. After that, in ICAP 2021, we extended this theory to also in a continuous setting. So we wondered, for me, this was more like a blueprint for going into the questions tackled in domain theory and better understanding Kamel and Plotkin's results canonically from a category theoretic perspective. But before going to non-Hausdorff setting as a stepping stone, we considered what happens in the category of compact Hausdorff spaces. And here we use the fact that this is a very nice regular category where we have a notion of well-studied notion of relations. So we can rely on results very similar to the ones of Bar, which were proved by Carboni, Kelly, and Wood. So we know how to extend functors from a regular category to the relations on these regular categories. And we also have a functor which very much resembles the power set monad, namely the Vietoris functor. And furthermore, the Kleissley category for this functor is not the same thing as the relations on regular categories. You have an additional continuity constraint. But nevertheless, piecing up together all these results, one can obtain the fact that we can lift we have an extension of the Vietoris functor to the category, first to the category of relations of compact Hausdorff spaces, and then we can show that this actually restricts the category, the Kleissley category of the Vietoris functor. And furthermore, using the fact that the multiplication of V satisfies a property of being nearly Cartesian, and then we show that we can prove a weak distributive law between of the Vietoris functor over itself. So this is very similar to having a weak distributive law of the power set functor over itself. And again, there is no hope of having a strong distributive law in this setting. The next step, this is something that is still open, is having a weak distributive law where instead of one of these Vietoris functors, we look at the Radon monad. So this is as close as we can get to probability distributions on compact Hausdorff spaces. And so this would be the analogous result between power set and finite distribution monad, but this time on compact Hausdorff spaces. So this is all a bit all that I wanted to talk about the weak distributive laws. I hope that all this array of results showed you that this is an interesting notion that deserves to be studied more in more detail. The next step is to get to the semi-free algebra part of the talk and to show that in some sense, weak distributive law could be in fact seen as strong if we tweak a bit the monads involved. So first of all, what is the link with semi-algebras? If I have some monad T, first of all, a semi-algebra for this monad, definition is somewhat hidden here, is an arrow from Tx to X, which satisfy only this associativity axiom. So I suppose that if I am in T square X and I do the multiplication to go to Tx and then I apply A, I obtain the same thing as composing A with Ta. So this is the associativity of my Eilenberg-Moore algebra. But the other axiom that usually is satisfied by all Eilenberg-Moore algebras, namely the fact that A composed with the unit is the identity, this axiom is not required. So this is why these are called semi-algebras, only one of the two axioms hold. And why are we interested in this category of semi-algebras? Well, if we spell out very carefully the proof by bar about the correspondence between strong distributive laws and liftings of S to T algebras, and then we see all the places where we are using the fact that the distributive law satisfies the unit of the monad T. Well, if we drop this axiom, we can recreate the proof of the fact that weak distributive laws of the form TS from ST are in one-to-one correspondences with liftings of the monad S to a monad, I'm calling it S tilde, but which is now defined on the category not of algebras for T, but of semi-algebras. So I am dropping the unit of T from the picture. So this is something that could be shown relatively easily. And in fact, it is one of the important stepping stones in, also in the proof in the paper of Garner. So in order to find the weak lifting, first of all, he uses this lifting of S to the semi-algebras of T, and then he has to split some idempotent to obtain the lifting of the weak lifting of S to the whole category of algebras for T. So this is where semi-algebras play a crucial role in the proof of in this theory of weak distributive laws. And and this is something that the next step is to understand a bit better what are semi-algebras, because semi-algebras are still arrows from, and you can think of it as a way of completing terms in some equational theory, right? And you have this associativity, it's just that you are dropping the axiom with the unit. So it seems that they are still algebraic. And this is actually an insight for which, so I was talking to Martin Highland at some point in Paris, and he was asking this question, but they are algebraic in some sense, in what sense? And somehow this was the starting point for the project, for the master project in which I involved Ralph Sarkis. We started by looking out at some examples for this and try to understand what are semi-algebras for some very basic monads. And in our paper, we have much more examples that I'm going to put here on the slides. The first one, perhaps the easier to understand, is if we consider the maybe monad on set. So this is the monad that to a set X is associating X plus one. So what is an Eilenberg-Moore algebra for T? It turns out that these are just pointed sets. So it's a map from X plus one to X. Because of the axiom involved, this is equivalent to just selecting one point in X. So if you think about them from the universal algebraic perspective, this amounts to considering the algebras where you have a very simple signature, you only have one constant, this bullet of with arity zero, and you don't have any equation involved. Okay? So the next question that we asked ourselves is, what are the semi-algebras for the maybe monad? Okay? And in for semi-algebras, A composed with eta is no longer the identity. We can nevertheless show, and this can be done in general, that it is an idempotent. Okay? And it turns out that the semi-algebras for the maybe monad, they can be presented by the following equational theory. So you have this bullet, the constant, and now you are adding an idempotent. So this is this operation with arity one. And in the equations, you specify that this A is the idempotent. And also the fact that A bullet is equal to bullet. And you check by hand that if you look at the algebras that's presented by these operations and these equations, they can be seen as maps from X plus one to X satisfying only the associativity axiom with respect to the multiplication of the maybe monad. Okay, so you add this, the A here could be interpreted as this idempotent, A composed with eta x. Okay, so this is one half of the proof. And moreover, this idempotent plays again a crucial role if you look at other examples. So the next example, which could be very interesting to look at, is the finite distribution monad. So if you look at all the of the algebras for D, I mentioned this briefly in the beginning, you have an operation plus P, where P is some real number between 0 and 1. So this is a binary operation subject to this skew commutativity, to some skew associativity axiom. If you look at all the algebras for D, you should have also an idempotent solution. You should have that x plus px is equal to x. But now, if you look at semi-algebras, to this theory, you should add one unary idempotent, this A, and you should add the following equations. So
yeah, Daniela, so could you stop for a second? Something happened here with the big screen. If you could just pause for a second.
Sure. Sorry. I was not looking at the videos. I didn't.
It's okay. Everything runs fine on one computer, but just not projected on the main.
Do you want me to go back to some slide or?
Well, it happened fairly recently. I'm not sure how many slides. But wait until we fix it either way.
Okay, I wait for you to fix the technical issue.
It doesn't look like we're going to resolve it soon. Do you think you could, without the video? Okay, so yeah, it doesn't look like we're going to be able to resolve it. Maybe the best thing we can do, could you maybe give a summary that doesn't require slides? And we'll try to proceed with just audio.
Right. Or I don't know how many people in the audience do have computers and can log into Zoom themselves. That could also...
Some people can see the slides. Some can, but some don't.
Right. I can summarize. I can continue, I don't know, for those who have the slides. Well, I can do it with just audio. For those who can see the slides, maybe if they can share with the neighbors that don't, that would be a one solution, partial solution. And otherwise, I can continue. I mean, I will try to explain the best I can, only assuming that there are some people in the audience who don't see what is going on.
Okay, we'll use our PCs then to see the slides.
Right. So what was happening, what is happening on the slides, and I'm trying to give some concrete equational presentations for the concept of semi-algebras and how one can add one operation to the presentation, to the usual presentation of algebras for a monad, and then some additional equation satisfying, showing that this operation is an idempotent, and also how it interacts with the other equations that are already present there, in order to obtain again a equational presentation for the concept of semi-algebra. Okay, so for example, in an algebra for D, I would have the equation that x plus px is equal to x. So it means that if x happens with probability p and x happens with probability 1 minus p, then you have x. But if you drop the axiom involving the unit of D, this axiom is no longer necessarily true. You will, so in a semi-algebra, we would have an axiom where I have x plus px is actually equal to a, this idempotent a applied to x. At any rate, the message that has to come from this example is that the concept of semi-algebras, it's still very algebraic in notion. So you still have presentation by operations and equation. And this means that in principle, you should be able to obtain semi-algebras as algebras for a monad. So this is the main result that that appeared in my paper with Ralph Sarkis last year, namely that if I have a monad T on a category which is just assumed to have coproducts, then on the functor identity on C plus T, we can put a monad structure. Do you want me to stop again? I'm sorry, I didn't catch.
Sorry,
Daniela.
Yeah, maybe
myself.
Yes. I think most people now have it on their own machines, so I think you can continue.
Okay. Okay. So what I was saying is that if I have a category C, which is assumed to have coproducts, then on the functor identity plus T, we can put a monad structure. This is will be called the semi-free monad TS. And in such a way that there is an isomorphism between the semi-algebras for T, so this is the category MS, Eilenberg-Moore subscript S of T. So here we have the maps from TX to X, satisfying only the associativity with respect to the multiplication. And on the other hand, we have all the Eilenberg-Moore algebras for this semi-free monad. So we call it semi-free monad because there is some form of analogy between the free monad on a functor, where if you start with a functor, you can build the free subject to some conditions, you can build the free monad such that the Eilenberg-Moore algebras of the monad are the algebras for the functor. And here we have this correspondence between algebras for the semi-free monad and semi-algebras for the original monad. The unit for this semi-free monad TS is simple, so this is just the in left arrow from identity to identity plus T. So here we are not using the unit. T is assumed to be a monad, but we are not using the unit of T to build the unit of this semi-free algebra monad TS. On the other hand, we are using the unit of T in order to build the multiplication of mu S. How we are doing this? Maybe one can, sorry to interrupt you, but maybe you can mute Omar so that at least I'm hearing the noises from the room, which are, or if you are muting the mic for Omar, that would. Okay, thank you. So now I'm trying to describe what is the multiplication mu s. So this is ts squared, and this is will be identity plus t applied to identity plus t. And I have to produce an arrow going from this functor to identity plus t. So I will obtain this as the sum of the next two arrows. So on the part identity plus t, I'm just doing the identity. And on the second part, I have to go from t of the identity plus t to identity plus t. So how do I do this? I map this identity here also to t using eta. So using t of eta plus identity, I can go to t square. I applied the multiplication of t to go to t. And then I do an in right to go to identity plus t. it's a bit technical, and showing that this actually satisfied all the axioms of the multiplication and delta requires some work and nothing very tricky, but I spelled this out nevertheless on the slides because I want to point out one thing. The fact that here we are not, I mean, we still assume that T has a unit on the multiplication, because there was a question that was asked to me whether we can start with a semi-monad, so a functor with a multiplication, and if this is the free way of obtaining a monad structure or such a thing. And well, it's not quite, because we are using the eta of T in order to obtain this semi-free monad. Okay. But nevertheless, we with these two constructions for the unit and the multiplication, we obtain this construction and this correspondence between semi-algebras for T and algebras for TS. And furthermore, you obtain that the presentations. So if you look at the concrete presentation for this monad, in the case of T being maybe, or the finite distributions, or some other examples that we have in the paper with Ralph, you get exactly what you want. So now, coming back to the correspondences that I wanted to speak about in the beginning, you have that the weak distributive laws from TS to ST, well, they are in one-to-one correspondences with strong distributive laws involving the monads TS, so the semi-free monad, and S. And we can also characterize which distributive laws between these two monads give rise to a weak distributive law. So you have one additional axiom. It's a rather nasty condition. I did not want to put it on the slides. It's in the paper with Ralph, which characterizes the distributive laws between TS and S. That give rise to weak distributive laws between T and S. And how do you prove this? Well, a weak distributive law from TS to ST corresponds, as I have described before, to a lifting of S to the semi-algebras for T, but the semi-algebras for T are the algebras for TS. So if you have a lifting of S to algebras for TS, using Beck's results, this gives rise to a strong law between TS and S. And furthermore, all the examples that we have about how to add this idempotent unary operations and how to obtain presentations. So at the end of our paper, we had a conjecture there that this result actually can be generalized to any finitary equation theory. We put it at the end as a conjecture. We didn't actually have the time to prove it before the deadline. But then a PhD student in the Netherlands, Rosette and Hansen and Andrulis have proved this open problem, and they show that we can always obtain a concrete algebraic presentation of the semi-free monad TS from the monad T by adding an idempotent and some suitable equations. So you also have a concrete way of presenting this. So just to summarize, the results that I presented in this talk, they appeared in these papers that were jointly written with Alexandre Goy, with Mark Higuet, and with Ralph Sarkis. And you can find there much more. Yeah, so it's just the slide before last. So so I was just saying that this is the literature, and just to say the last bit about the future work, it would be still interesting to study this notion of semi-free monad also from a more theoretical perspective, like from the formal theory of monads perspective. And to investigate work the relationship between similar work involving semi-algebras in the two categorical settings. So Martin Highland and Christine Tasson have some work there, they are motivated by the linear to non-linear substitutions. Furthermore, here we obtain another way of composing monads in the presence of weak distributive laws, which is different than the way that Richard Garner is doing in his paper. And it would be again interesting to see if this could be used from a semantic point of view. And finally, in there are a lot of questions in this continuous setting that I only skimmed through at some point in the talk. So anyway, I do apologize for all the technical issues that came about, and I'm sorry my computer crashed right now. So I'm happy to receive any questions now.
Thanks a lot, Daniela. So let's all thank Daniela first of all.